ask you to bring your private conversations to conclusion that we can begin our meeting on tonight. As always, we count it for it is another blessing of the Lord that we are able to come together to this point of worship in the study of God's Word. Trust that everybody has had a decent day today.
Oh, yeah.
Amen. I said, oh, yeah. Even amidst all of the adversity, God is still good.
Amen. Amen.
God is still good.
Yes.
If you would you bow your heads with me for a word of prayer and then we'll go for it. Father, we thank you, Lord, once again today for this day that you made. We thank you for all that you have provided and continue from our birth to this present moment. Thank you, Father. We pray you now that you will be pleased to come and be our instructor on tonight. Such things as we are standing in need of individually and collectively as a church family. We pray that you would always be pleased, dear God, to use these times together for our building, for our molding and making into the image, the very likeness of Jesus our Lord. Bless us now, we pray you, in Jesus' name. And they all said amen.
Amen. Amen.
Okay. Once again, good evening to everybody. It is good to see so many of you as are here. What is this y'all eating on? A hot dog?
False.
Peter didn't. So who did Peter stay with?
I'm of the town of Little. That's found in Acts what?
9:43.
9:41.
43.
9:43. Acts 9:43.
Yes, sir.
So he stayed. He stayed in Joppa with Simon, the ten. One more question, and then we'll go to our. Say again. Simon was the what? He was a tanner. He dealt with leather goods, did he?
Yes, he did.
Mighty fine. Okay. What nationality was the soldier? A name of Cornelius.
Italian.
And that's found where?
Acts 10:1.
It says that Cornelius was an Italian?
Yes.
Let's get one more. Let's do one more. What was the purpose of Peter being sent to the house of Cornelius?
See.
That's okay. That's okay. What was the purpose of Peter being sent to the house of Cornelius? To show the Jews, so that Jews and Gentiles can worship together? To let Cornelius know that God has heard his prayers? To teach again that the gospel is for the salvation of all men everywhere.
Yeah, that one.
See.
10:31. Right?
10:31. Acts 10:31. Okay. Prayer has been heard, your arms are remembered in the sight of God. Send that boy to Joppa and call Simon. Wait a minute, not 30.
No,
not
even 31.
I guess not.
Okay. Then Peter opened his mouth and said, in truth, I perceive that God chose no partiality, but in every nation, whoever fears him and works righteousness is accepted by him. Okay?
Yep.
Thank you. Let's go to our text. Gotta catch up with our. We gonna catch up? Let's try. Okay. Kings, I should say. they put a man over women that had been castrated because they thought that if they would castrate a man, that would do something to a man's heart. But anyhow, that's another talk.
I'm with you.
Philip has right across the eunuch. You remember, the eunuch was reading in the book of Isaiah, and he asked Philip about who's the fellow talking about. And the Bible says that Philip shared with him the gospel of Jesus Christ. And the Word of God says that as they were going along, no doubt that in that conversation, in his witness to the eunuch, he told him about being baptized and what that meant also. Not just talk about baptism, but about what baptism meant. And the eunuch asked of him, as they were passing, he says, "Here's some water here. What is it that would hinder me from being baptized?" And you remember Philip said to him, if you truly believe in your heart, as who Jesus is and what he has done, he said, you ought to be baptized. And the Bible says that they both went in the water. And after that, the Word of God says that Philip was called away of the Holy Spirit. Okay. Then Saul, still breathing threats and murders against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked letters from him to the synagogues of Damascus, so that if he found any who were of the way, whether men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. As he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly a light shone around him from heaven. He fell to the ground. Heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" And he said, "Who are you, Lord?" Then the Lord said, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. It is hard for you to kick against the goads." So Saul then, to come up to this point, Saul has gotten some authority now from the Judaizers in Jerusalem. On his way to Damascus, that he can bring whomever he finds, men and women, didn't make any difference. That he can put them in, take them into custody, and then bring them back to Jerusalem. And now you remember, this is the same guy that you remember Stephen, as Stephen was witnessing to the council, as it were. This is the same man that held, he didn't do any stone throwing at Stephen. But Paul is the one that Bible says that he held their garments. And I don't know if you've ever thought about it. I know you've probably heard the story so many times, but just understand. Now you talk about guilt by association. He's making sure that everybody is comfortable. In other words, he's holding their outer garments so that there won't be any restraint from them. You know what I'm saying? You know, if you want to throw something, you want to take off your, so that you'll have all of the thrust, all of the strength that you can, all of the accuracy that you can. So Paul said, "Here, I'll hold y'all's coats. Get comfortable with it." And so he was for murdering Stephen because he was for, as he believed, God. And he felt as though Stephen was against God. And he had the kind of zeal about him. That's something about a zealous person. And that's how come these men, and these children that ISIS is using, they are believers. Okay? They are giving their lives for, as they believe, God's name. They're giving their lives, and when in jihad, when you give your life in jihad, that's one of the only ways that a Muslim guarantees that he gets to paradise. That's right. To die in jihad. You need a guarantee. So it's something what believers, even though, and that's how come, see, in the church, you can be sincere and be sincerely wrong. That's why the word of God says, make your calling and election sure. Make your calling sure. And what you elect to do with that calling, and who has elected you to do it. It says, make it sure. And the only way, the only surety, actually two aspects of surety, the Holy Spirit within, and how it reconciles with the Word of God. If you're saying one thing with your mouth and living something else with your life, something is jacked. Saul got the authority, got the letters. He's on his way to Damascus, and the Bible says, and suddenly, now stick a pin in this. Suddenly, a light shone around him from heaven. Then he fell to the ground and heard a voice. Now, anybody ever heard of some light knocking somebody down? Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah, like me.
Like me ain't light. But it says a light shone round about it, and that's another thing too. Now here it is. Here it is, and suddenly a light shone round about him, and now this light was from where?
Heaven.
Heaven.
Heaven. Oh.
Heaven.
Then he fell to the ground, and the light shone, and ain't nobody hit that night. He wasn't startled by the voice, anything like that. The light shone, and he fell to the ground. Then he heard the voice. Mm-hmm. Get that stuff?
Got his attention.
It showed up. Mm-hmm. And heard a voice say, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he said, who are you, Lord? Now, Saul is not recognized. Now, look at the text too. Pay attention to the text and know this. Saul is not recognizing Jesus as Lord. This is, the word that's here, Lord, is akin to our word, sir. Okay? He's not recognizing Jesus as the Lord here. It's like, how are you today, Lord? Okay. In that vernacular, you know. But now then, this is Luke writing. Then the Lord, he ain't saying then the sir. Right. Luke ain't. Right. Then the Lord said, I'm Jesus, whom you're persecuting. It's hard for you to kick against the goals. Anybody know what a goal is?
Play out, if you will, and as you
And I'm hopeful that I'm causing you to think about this. And I know you've heard this story 9,000,000 times. You may have read it just over and over again. But now, he stops Saul on the Damascus Road. And he does not just kill him right then. Everything. He could have just told him right then what thus and so, thus and so, thus and so, thus and so. But he does not. He says to Saul, after Saul says to Jesus, "Now, I know what I want to do. I'm coming down here to persecute or to bring, to incarcerate, if you will. I'm coming here to incarcerate the church for their blasphemies against our God and so on and so forth, against being even a Jew, as it were." And now, all of a sudden, he hears the voice of Jesus, and he asks Jesus this question: "What do you want me to do?" What is it that you want me to do? And instead of the Lord answering him, I'm talking about now. This isn't answering Saul's question. So I'm saying to us, do you ever ask God, "Well, what is it that you want?" What is it that you want from me? Well, why can't I have? Well, I've been praying about this thing. How come you just won't give me a straightforward answer like you gave Moses? When Moses talked to you, you told Moses, so on, so on. But now, in talking to Paul, go into the city and it will be told what you're going to do. And now, he's not asking anybody else, he's asking Jesus. But he said, "Go into it and it will be told what you must do." Now here's the thing about this. What if Paul hadn't did that?
Yeah,
same way he did Job. Well, my point is, Jesus, watch this. Jesus puts it again on Saul to do what he said to do. Right. Mm-hmm. That's what I want you to get. He didn't tell Saul, "You have to do this." Right. He said, "Oh, you don't know? Go into the city, and it'll be told to you." Okay. And the men who journeyed with him stood speechless, hearing a voice, but didn't see anybody. Then Saul arose from the ground. When his eyes were opened, he didn't see anybody. Now get it. What is it that you want me to do, Lord? He ain't opened his eyes yet. He's not trying to look at who he's hearing. What is it that you want me to do? Go into the city. Then he said, and when he opened his eyes, he was blind. Lord have mercy. He can't read them orders that he had. Woo child.
But do you think he obeyed the orders because it was Jesus speaking, or because he couldn't see and he was scared?
I think the answer to that question is yes. To all of them. Certainly, it appears from the text that he did not, when that light hit him and he fell to the ground, Secondly, he had about himself that this is not just something that happens on the Damascus Road.
Right.
Right?
Right. Oh.
Exactly. But Saul had his eyes closed. Now watch this. But the folk that was traveling with him,
right,
they was looking.
Right.
Well, how you know they were looking? How you know they were looking, Brother Parker? Because they said they heard a voice and didn't see nobody. That's what the text said. They could hear. They could hear voice, but didn't see it. They hear voice and look around. And Paul ain't looking around. Paul is on the ground. What you want me to do? Sure enough, trembling. Somebody like, yes, Sister Harris said he was trembling. Sure enough. Go into the town and you'll be told. And you'll notice that Jesus didn't even tell him who was going to tell him.
No.
He told Abraham, he said, go to a place where I'm going to show you. And for you and for me, we've never seen his face. He's saying to us and to anyone, trust the gospel of Jesus Christ and I will reveal myself to you. He is revealing himself to Saul. Okay? All right. They heard a voice but didn't see anybody. Then Saul arose from the ground. His eyes were opened, he saw no one. But they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. And he was 3 days without sight, and neither ate or drank. How many days was it?
Three.
There was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias. That's a popular name, isn't it? Ananias. And to him the Lord said in a vision, Ananias. And he said, here I am, Lord. So the Lord said to him, arise, go to the street called Straight or Narrow, and inquire at the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus. Saul of Tarsus. For behold, he is doing what?
Praying.
Who told him to pray? Ananias was to go to Judas's house because Paul had got to Damascus and was at Judas's house doing what?
Praying.
Who told him to pray? Amen. Mother said he was a Pharisee, he was a Jew. And so in this condition now, he's blind. And now, to go from being one of the baddest men in Rome, now he needs someone to lead him wherever he goes. It's something what sight does for folk. In so many instances, folks, a lot of folk would be better off if they were blind. You know, like somebody got getting a crush on Beyonce.
Oh.
No. Okay, here we go. Here we go. Right in the mess with you. He went to Judas's house, and he found a Saul. For Jesus said to Ananias that this fellow is there and he is doing what again?
Praying.
He's praying. He's talking to God. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias coming in and putting his hand on him so that he might receive his sight. Now, get this. Paul is blind.
Right.
But Paul, in his blindness, gets a vision.
Okay.
Stick a pin. He can't see, can he?
Right.
If he can't, but he can't see, but he can see, can he?
Yeah.
Now, in a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias coming in, putting his hand on him so that he might receive his sight. All of this stuff Paul has in his remembrance as he is living out his life. What happened on the Damascus Road, and we're going to hear a couple of accounts of Paul telling about the Damascus Road experience, what happened on the Damascus Road. But now, I was saying to someone a few days ago how that when you are saved and the Lord has revealed himself, shown up truly to your heart, to your mind, from that point on, you are good for nothing except serving him. Mm-hmm. I don't care what you were trying. When the Lord changes your heart, changes your mind, from that moment on, you are good for nothing else except serving him. He was blind, but he had a vision. Then Ananias answered, "Lord, I've heard from many about this man, how much harm he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And here, he has authority from the chief priests to bind all who call on your name." That was something for the scared church to learn. Ananias is scared of Paul. He's so afraid of Paul that he even questions Jesus's command to go. He said, "Wait a minute. Wait a minute. I heard about this man. But folk have a reputation amongst us. And now there. And now you think about these 50, 60 men I was just talking to over here in this institution. And they go home now. Saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Spirit. And they're coming into a church full of y'all." Straight out of the penitentiary. Saved. Sanctified. And they're coming to Ananias. 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 But the Lord said to him, go, for he is, what you say now?
Oh, no.
So the man that helped murder Stephen, the man that Ananias knows, because the word that got out from Jerusalem now to Damascus and all over the landscape, this fellow Paul is running roughshod in the church. And now Jesus says that he is a chosen vessel. I'm saying to these men in the institution, when you go to your, if they go, and see that, what's this here? In the institution, when I said, I'm giving them some instruction, I say now, go into the city. To a, what's this here? To a Bible-believing church. And that, for Paul, good God, I'm going to have to chew on that one. I'll bring it to you one more again.
Okay.
Here. He is a chosen vessel, watch this here now, of
mine.
To bear my name before the Gentiles, kings, and the children of Israel. For I will show him how many things he must what?
Suffer.
Don't nobody want to do that? That's why we close up. That's why the church closed up today. Nobody wants to do this. And now, Jesus is saying, I'm going to show him the things that he must. Now, I'm not just going to let it happen to him first. I'm going to give him some instruction about that. This is what they learn. And that is so much like our Lord, who knew at his coming what he was going to suffer for you and for me. But the question is, what is it that we are willing to suffer for his name's sake? Some folks say, I'm too old to suffer. I'm too old. I'm on this side of, I'm in the golden years. I'm in the golden years. Ain't no suffering for. Wait a minute. Ain't no suffering for the golden years, is it?
Yes, sir.
It sure is. Because the golden years are not by themselves.
Right.
There's still some suffering to do, because the golden years got children. Golden years, shut up! The golden years got grandchildren. The golden years got husbands and wives.
Yes.
See? There's some suffering to be done. They said, well, brother, what does that have to do with for my name's sake? Because there are other choices that could be made in these instances that are out of the will of God. See? I've shown him what things he must suffer for my name's sake. Ananias went his way, entered the house, laid hands on him, he said. And now, isn't it something that when Jesus talks to his saints, there is no, I'm talking about, Jesus didn't have to explain himself to Ananias. He could have said, man, I told you to go over there. And,
me. And now, as Jesus is talking,
I go for
it. And I said, wait a minute. I know what I had about him. And now, as Jesus is talking back to his servant now is coming into peace. His servant now is calming down in his mind and in his heart. He's coming down off of the law. You know what I'm saying? Caution. And listening to the voice and the command of his Savior. And that's what Christ does in us as we listen to him. You get what I'm saying? Don't go all half-cocked just on what you think, what you heard. What is the Lord ministering to you about? What's this here? About what you heard. See? So now, why you say he calmed down? Because by the time Ananias gets to Judas's house, Saul is now his brother. He is in the house, put his hands on him, and said, what?
Brother son.
That's what I'm talking about.
I got some
brothers over there in the institution. They tell me that they said, Brother Isaac, they said, well, I ain't got but a few more months now. We gonna be over. I said, come on, brother. Stop by and see him before you go home, before you make your, I said, come on by, brother. Yeah. The Lord Jesus will appear to you on the road as you came, has sent me that you may receive your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, Paul, watch this now. Paul was praying without the Holy Ghost. Why you say that? Because you just read it. Paul was praying without the Holy Ghost. And I don't know exactly what he, certainly I do. He was praying about, he found himself in some trouble and that kind of thing. But God had already laid out what it was going to be for him. If in fact you are saved, God has your roadmap already done. Every victory, with every disappointment, God has it already calculated. It's already dialed up, Peter. Whatever you must go through, it's a done deal. And that's how come you need to have an attitude about whatever you're going through, at least, and see that, this is how Brother Parker lived. I live like this. I win. Oh yeah, I'm crying. Yeah. My heart gets broken. I win. We win. The victory is ours. In Christ Jesus.
So,
yes.
So, Saul was not saved until basically when the brother came in and told him, when he was talking to Jesus on the road, he was just learning what was in store for him.
Sure.
But when he got the laying of the hand from Ananias, that was the indication of the beginning of him, the moment where he was beginning to be saved.
Sure. And if, in case you didn't hear, he was talking about, well, when was Saul actually saved? When was he showing up saved? The word of God says that any man that does not have the Spirit of God is none of his. That's the Bible. So then, where Paul was absent of the indwelling of the Spirit, he was not saved. Without the Spirit, no salvation. You can be a great, in fact, the business is, when we get to Cornelius' house, the Bible calls Cornelius' band God-fearers. We're going to read it. Cornelius was a God-fearer, but he was not saved. That's another thing too. Paul, though he wasn't saved, I say it's not. I said, though Paul was not saved, he was chosen. The Jews were God's chosen.
Right.
Okay. They were God's chosen people, but now, without the Holy Ghost, and God said, I did not choose you because you were the best of, the prettiest, the brightest.
Right.
We know, because God, Jesus said it. Jesus told Ananias, he is my chosen vessel. Mm-hmm. Right?
Right.
But up until the time when the Spirit, the keeping power of God, indwelled him, he was not saved. Chosen, yeah. It's just like you. If in fact you are saved, God chose you from eternity. Chose. When was he saved? Without the Holy Ghost, you are not saved. Without the Holy Spirit. Somebody said, well, what about that fellow on the cross? What about the thief on the cross? Was he filled with the Holy Ghost? Watch this. The Bible says that you cannot say sincerely what that thief said if he was not saved by the Spirit of the living God. What did he say? First of all, he told other people, he said, you need to be quiet.
Yeah.
He said, you and me, we deserve all of this that we've got. He said, but this man has done nothing but good. Raised in the dead, healed in the sick, this man. And then he said, Lord, when you enter into your kingdom, now you
can't ask to go if you don't know.
He recognized that Jesus was the King of glory.
Yes, he did.
something like scales. Mm. And he received his sight at once. And he arose
and was baptized.
While he was at, see, that's another thing too. Who told him to get baptized? All that's in the story. You need to think about these things. Come out. Here he is. He's over a Judas's house. He's praying. He doesn't have the Holy Spirit. But he has seen. He's. I would imagine if I was Paul, if I was Lois Paul, I'd say, wait a minute, I can't see, but I see something. Faith, that's what I'm saying, mother. Faith is being able to see something when ain't nothing there. Faith, I'm telling you, faith in God will let you see some things that everybody can't see.
Amen.
All right.
The thief on the cross saw. That other thief didn't see it. The other thief was still blind. That's his head. You had, what's this? Two blind folk. And one somebody with all sight.
Then the Father sees fit to give one of some Jesus eyes.
Somebody told Saul had heard of Jesus baptizing in his name and all that. How blasphemous it was for someone to name the name of God and consider himself. The Jews thought that was blasphemy. That's how come they said they want to kill Jesus, because he makes himself equal with God.
Now that he can see, he said what the Ethiopian eunuch said, get me to some water.
I'm gonna get this water right now. Yeah. So when he had received food, he was strengthened. Mm-hmm. Then Saul spent some days with the disciples at Damascus. See here, I don't know if any of you have ever fasted before. Paul had not eaten anything, we read, for 3 days. And in that time, he was getting weaker. Okay? If you've ever fasted, what I wanted to share is that I've heard of churches that call a fast for a particular thing, and the minister, whomever, calling the fast, and he does not teach the folk about fasting. Don't just put something on people because it sounds, they fasted in the Bible. But now, you need to have some understanding about what fasting is and what to fast for. Why do you fast? Why would you fast? Well, now, Saul was fasting not as a follower of Jesus Christ. He was fasting as a Jew in bewilderment. What I'm saying to you is that when a Christian fasts, it's different, because you will be sustained by what Jesus says, and here's what it says. Word of God says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. So now, if your body said, man, you ain't fed me nothing today,
and you say, it's just like I was fasting last week. And let me tell you what, I was fasting from Dr. Pepper.
All right.
Shut up. Man, doctor, that's mine. Drink. Every day. And I got to the point, I said, wait a minute, man. I was drinking Dr. Pepper's cause this said drinking. So I told him, I said, man, you ain't gonna tell me what to do with that Dr. Pepper. None this week. And sure enough, come time for me to get my, this said you better get that Dr. Pepper. I said, I ain't studying. So then, I said that to say this, and I'm going on now. I completed. I said I was going to go a week. No Dr. Pepper, no soda, nothing. I said I'm going 7 days. I'm going on 10 days. And it's not because the desire doesn't come.
See?
So what I'm saying to you about fasting is not just about eating nothing for 3 days or seven, you know. But now, the thing that you have in your life that's regulating what you do about the thing, when the thing is instructing you, the thing and your flesh, they say, well, we Siamese twin. You need to tell your flesh, I'm in control. And it's like I was telling you, even though I joke about it all the time, about the Beyonce thing, well now, I realized what that was in me. It was lust. So I don't mess with Beyonce. I'm just saying to you, in all seriousness, when I find those kinds of things, and now you talk about, and I'm kind of hit. Paul was weak. I wanted to share with you. Because he was not fasting as a saint, as a follower of Jesus Christ. The thing that you need to fast from, and as you're fasting, God will strengthen you. He'll give you the vigor and the vim. Watch this here. It's just like when Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, when they went to the king's palace and they wanted to feed them their food. Daniel told the person in charge, he said, look, he said, I know you got a job to do. He said, but if you just let us be us, and they didn't eat what the rest of the folk would eat, and they were more healthy than all the folk that ate the steak and the lobster. Do y'all hear me? Don't let your weakness be in control. No matter what that weakness is, it will make you weak. So he ate and spent some days with the disciples at Damascus. Immediately he preached the Christ in the synagogue. That is, that he is the Son of God. Then all who heard were amazed and said, is this not he who destroyed those who called on this name in Jerusalem and has come here for that purpose? You know, he's come down to Damascus for
to take some folk in custody so that he might bring them bound to the chief priest. But Saul increased all the more in strength. And now, this strength here is not talking about his physical vigor, okay? And confounded the Jews who dwelt in Damascus, proving that this Jesus is the Christ. He did it by his tremendous knowledge of the Word of God, okay? He was a Jew of Jews, as it were. Now, after many days were passed, the Jews plotted to him. What did they plot to do? That's a theme going through this text, isn't it?
Yeah.
Stephen get to preaching, and folk get to talking to Jesus, and what people want to do to him?
Kill him.
In the United States, right now, folks. Yes, indeed. But their plot became known to Saul, and they watched the gates day and night to kill him. Then the disciples took him by night, led him down through the wall in a large basket. And when Saul had come to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, but they were what?
Afraid.
And didn't believe that he was a disciple. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles. And he declared to them how he had seen the Lord on the road, and that he had spoken to him. And now, here again. Now watch this. And this he, do you know who this is? Okay. Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles. And he declared to them how he had seen and
saw.
Okay. And he declared to them how he had seen the Lord on the road, and that he had spoken to him, and how he had preached boldly at Damascus in the name of Jesus. Mm-hmm. Now, this he is who?
Saul.
This he is Barnabas. Okay. And Barnabas declared to them how Paul had seen the Lord on the road, and that he, it's a capital H right here.
Jesus.
Okay. And that Jesus had spoken to him. Mm-hmm. Okay, sorry. Right. And how he had preached. Now this is Barnabas telling them how Paul had preached boldly at Damascus in the name of Jesus. So then, what I want to show you here, and Barnabas declared to the apostles how Paul had what?
Seen.
He claimed that Saul had seen Jesus.
But I'm back up here with you. I'm not sure.
You're not sure?
That first he is Barnabas. How sure it could be Saul himself, where it said Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles. And he, talking about him, and he declared to them how he, him, Saul, the Lord on the road.
Who's doing the action?
And Saul declared.
Who's doing the action?
Barnabas.
Right.
We're talking about Barnabas.
Right, right.
And how Barnabas introduced Saul to the apostles. So let's let Barnabas introduce Saul to the apostles.
Okay.
This is how he did it.
Okay.
And Barnabas took Saul and brought him to the apostles, and Barnabas declared to them. Barnabas is telling them about
Saul.
Oh.
Yes.
But couldn't Paul himself declare to them how he had seen?
You'll
be the first person.
Read the verse 26.
Exactly.
And when Saul had come to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples,
right,
but they were afraid of him and did not believe he was a disciple. So at this point, to me, it would not have mattered what Paul said,
exactly,
without verification from someone else,
exactly,
that he's not going to speak. But Barnabas is speaking, and he is verifying who Saul is.
Okay.
Okay, let's get back to that scene thing right quick.
But it didn't seem.
Sure. And Barnabas declared to them how Paul had seen the Lord on the road, and that the Lord or Jesus had spoken to Paul, and how Paul had preached boldly at Damascus in the name of Jesus.
But how did Barnabas know that Saul had seen Jesus on the road to Damascus? Because Saul told him, correct?
Sure. This is what I will say. The story of Saul in Damascus had to spread like
wildfire.
And the men that accompanied Paul from Jerusalem to Damascus, they were there, weren't they?
Yeah.
When they told the story to somebody, they said, we heard something, but we didn't see anybody. But now, Saul, he was crossed over on the trembling, shaking, and he was talking. We could hear him talking to somebody. We heard some talking from Saul, but we didn't hear. We didn't hear. So then, what was told to the folk was that Paul met Jesus on the Damascus Road. What did he see?
He
did see
the light.
He saw a light from
heaven.
Is that right?
Yes.
He saw, that's what the Bible means. Go back and read it again. It says that he saw a light shone from
heaven.
Who's the light?
Jesus.
But now, God wasn't in the bush.
Right.
What's out here about Matthias? Yeah. And they all say amen?
Amen.
God is good, isn't it?
Yes.
The Bible, Paul says that the light was shone brighter than the noonday sun. But when we get to chapter 22, I think it is, when he's telling the cripple. He said it was a light that was, it shone. It wasn't dark. Say it one more time. Amen.
Amen.
Would you bow with me? Lord, we thank you again for your word, Lord. Thank you always for this time together of fellowship. We pray always that something is received for our better help, that we can fight better, that we can stand better. In the blessed name of Jesus, Lord, we ask that you would continue to bless these efforts, that we are in your hands for times like these.
Yes.
And I'm reminded on tonight, one of our members, a couple of our members actually, Lord, tonight has lost a loved one.
Yes.
And we pray for Barnes, our family at large, in this hour of bereavement. We pray you now. From what I understand, it is just another tragic circumstance, Lord. I pray you that, that the ones that are yet alive can learn something for their life. We pray that this light that Paul saw would show itself in and throughout their family now. The ones that know you, Heavenly Father, help them to be comforted as they can. And you comfort them as their hearts surely are broken to some degree or another. We thank you, dear Lord, that you are there for us in every circumstance. So we pray again, go down with us from this place as you have always in times past. We'll give you the glory, the honor, all of yours anyhow. And the people of God said together, amen.